Thank you, Barry, for that kind introduction. It's really a pleasure to be here today, to be able to share with you all the ongoing progress that's occurring at the Bing Center for Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia. I just literally got back from a 12-hour stay in Brazil, where I had gone to lecture to Latin American physicians who had gathered for a congress there, the Haematus Conference. And ibrutinib had just gotten approved in Latin America, so folks there were quite eager and excited to learn more about this drug and also to learn so much about Waldenstrom. But it really surprised me to see how excited they were to learn about Waldenstrom. All of them had patients. They presented to me many challenging cases, and they were all really eager to be able to have this new medicinal to be able to treat their patients. But the level of their questions, the sophistication of their questions is what really struck me, because I do this all over the planet, and it always excites me when you see people have such insights into Waldenstrom, to know about the MEDI8 mutation, the CXCR4 mutation, and how these apply to some of our new drug therapeutics. But the reason why I say this to you is because you can all be proud that the research that has been produced jointly, that has been funded by the IWMF, is really producing exciting results, and there are a lot of people all over the world that are now benefiting because of this progress. So all of you, when you go home tonight, you know, think about, you know, how much we've accomplished together. So in the next 45 minutes or so, that's a hand to you. In the next 45 minutes, you know, myself, along with my esteemed colleagues, Dr. Zachary Hunter and Dr. Guang Yang, we're going to present to you a lot of exciting new research. But I do want to take the opportunity to say something about these gentlemen. Zach Hunter first joined the Bing Center now, I think it's about 15, 16 years ago. And in that period of time, the work and contributions that he has made has been truly amazing. He initially started working in clinical trials. He was actually involved in some very, very challenging trials. As these matured, new therapeutics for Waldenstrom came about. But it was really his work in the genomics of the disease that has allowed us to make these pivotal discoveries. These are just really the first chapter in a very, very long book that I think is going to be producing a lot new data and a lot of new drugs, and we're going to hear about this today. Zach is also one of the Robert A. Kyle Award winners. In fact, he received this great honor at the Amsterdam workshop on Waldenstrom's 2 years ago. So Zach will actually start us off. And then another individual that I want to introduce to you is Dr. Guang Yang, who perhaps you don't know, a lot about. But if we have ibrutinib here today, it's really because of his fundamental work. You know, shortly after we discovered the MIDI8 mutation, he began to work on the circuitry that, was involved in the cell, how the MIDI8 mutation was signaling. And then afterwards, he did the same thing with CXCR4. But it's really the MIDI8 work that he did that allowed us to go to the FDA with the data showing, in fact, how MIDI8 turned on Bruton's tyrosine kinase, the target of ibrutinib. And it was really that impressive work that led to the FDA to give its first ever breakthrough designation in oncology. Think about that. That's in Waldenstrom's, to have the first breakthrough. And that allowed for the accelerated approval of ibrutinib. So we have so much to thank him and all the pivotal work that he's done on ibrutinib, and you're going to hear a lot about it today. We really owe this man, so much. So, Dr. Guang Yang. And so we're going to kick off here with Dr. Zach Hunter telling us about the genomics, and it's actually going to be a relay race here today, and you're going to see us just handing off to one another, and hopefully, at the end we'll have some questions and be able to wrap this up. Zach?
Thank you so much, Steve. And it's such a pleasure to be here. It's to be able to share the work that we're doing with the people we're doing it for is really one of the highlights for me every year. And so thank you for having us. And I'm the first element of the relay race here. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the initial bench work that we do as we start trying to figure out what makes Waldenstrom's work, a little bit about the history of Waldenstrom's, Steve's going to talk about the clinical side, and then how we move back from the clinic back to the bench to try to develop new therapies and make a difference in Waldenstrom's care. So as many of you know, Waldenstrom's was actually discovered by Jan Gosa Waldenstrom in 1944. And at the time, it was a little controversial. No one really totally knew what it was, and it stayed that way, actually, for a long time. It wasn't until 2002 in Athens that we actually have a group of physicians get together and come together and really say, hey, what is Waldenstrom's? How is this different from other B-cell malignancies, other kinds of lymphoma and myeloma? How do we diagnose it? And start to think about how do we treat it? And then it was actually in 2003, and yes, that is an embarrassingly young picture of me. Thank you, Steve. I'm just that we sat down and we're like, okay, we know what it is, but how are we gonna study this thing? How are we gonna beat this thing? We need to understand the genomics, we need to understand the signaling, we need to have a plan. And a group of us, really top genomics people in myeloma and lymphoma from the US and Canada, got together as a part of this international patient conference, actually, and started to think about this, lay plans. And a lot of this was made possible because in 2005, Peter Bing dedicated the Bing Center to Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia at the Dana-Farber Cancer Institute and provided the funding that we needed to really get this into high gear. So finally, in 2012 is when we really hit our first major breakthrough. I'm not to say there isn't a lot of other important stuff that wasn't done before then, but this is the first time we were able to definitively talk about what was driving Waldenstrom's macroglobulinemia, and it was a mutation in a gene known as MYD88, and this was published in the New England Journal of Medicine. And to do this, we had to look at the DNA that people were born with and compare it to the DNA that was in people's Waldenstrom cells. And what was sort of miraculous about this is that actually it's a single base pair. Of the 3 billion base pairs that you inherit from each of your parents, one of them had been switched. And it was the same one in almost every Waldenstrom's patient. Actually, in 93 to 97% of WM, this one base pair has been switched. And what's interesting is, I'm sure over the course of this weekend, you've heard a little bit about the precursor condition of IgM monoclonal gammopathy of undetermined significance, or MGUS. We can see it there too. So this is a really important early acquired mutation in WM. And these are results that have been actually validated, not just by us, but by many people across the world. I don't know if Steve Ansel is in the audience, but his group at the Mayo also looked at this, got 97% mutation rates in WM. So this is a really, really exciting time. So for the first time, we were able to identify what was driving Waldenstrom's and then start thinking about, once we know what's driving it, hey, can we figure out how to block that? How do we start thinking about how WM works, how the biology works? And so it really was this sort of new era in WM research. And you see an explosion of stuff from all across the world, of people working on this disease. And we could do things, for instance, like really improve our differential diagnosis. Other related diseases that used to be very hard to distinguish Waldenstrom's from don't have MYD88 mutations for the most part. So, whether it's marginal zone lymphoma or myeloma or chronic lymphocytic leukemia, the rates there are incredibly low. However, one thing I do want to point out is that this mutation rate in MGUS poses an interesting question, which is that if you see the MYD88 mutation in MGUS, this sort of precursor condition, what is it that's different about MGUS than WM? Right? How do we move from MGUS to WM? How does it go from being this benign, premalignant condition to being an active disease? And this is, again, something we'll talk about in a little bit, and it's also a really active area of research for us. So The other thing I would really like to point out is we talk about this as the L265P mutation because in WM, it's basically the L265P mutation. Almost everybody who is mutated for MYD88 has it at this position, but there are other activating mutations that exist. And in fact, in related diseases such as activated B-cell typed diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, it's actually only 29% of the mutations that they observe. And but the key thing here is that there are 2% of patients who have non-L265P mutations in WM. And this is really important because they're actually important clinical and prognostic implications for having the MYD88 mutation. And so if you're going to a doctor and you're getting tested, one of the things I hope that everyone comes away from this is that if you test negative for the L265P mutation, make sure you get tested for all of MYD88 and make sure that you're not part of this 2%. Because how the MYD88 mutant Waldenstrom's behaves is very different from how the wild type or normal MYD88 Waldenstrom's behaves. We'll talk about again here in just a few minutes. So what does this thing do? MYD88 is actually part of your immune signaling complex. It helps cells detect the presence of viruses and bacteria. And it's essentially tricking the cell into thinking that your body's under attack. And says, hey, we've got to grow, we've got to survive, we've got to fight this thing. It's not really there, but that's the signal it's sending out. And one of the ways it does this is by activating a protein called NF-kappa-B. And you can see it here as these sort of green dots in the center of these cells. And when we block MYD88 chemically, which we unfortunately do not know how to do in patients, we can actually remove all this NF-kappa-B out of the nucleus where the DNA is, eliminate the signaling, and actually ultimately kills the cells. So the first time we can actually really start thinking about how can we rationally design drugs to go after Waldenstrom cells. So Guangyang, who we're going to be hearing from a little bit later, actually broke down the signaling pathway and was able to show that activated MYD88 signals down through two different pathways. One is IRAK1 and 4, and another one is one that you may have actually heard of, a molecule called BTK, or Bruton's tyrosine kinase. And that's the target for ibrutinib. And all these pathways lead to NF-kappa-B. But the other thing is that it doesn't end there, and this was his second big insight, and actually has real implications for ibrutinib resistance, as we'll hear about later on today. NF-kappa-B, as I mentioned, is this pro-inflammatory. It's part of your immune system's like viral and bacterial detection system. So it wants to send these messages out to other cells, like, hey, we saw stuff, get excited, be aware, be on guard. And one of those messages is a protein or a signal called IL-6, which the cells themselves can pick up. So they'll submit this IL-6 signal, and their neighboring WM cells will pick it up, and that, in turn, activates a molecule called HCK, which activates BTK and ERK and other pro-survival signals and creates this loop. So we have this loop of MYD88 to BTK to NF-kappa-B, back to HCK, back to BTK. And this is the key insight that Guang has really made recently in WM. And how do we break this cycle is now the major focus of our research. So we talked a little bit about the fact that we see these MYD88 mutations present in IgM MGUS, and we also see them in Waldenstrom's, and so what's changed? Well, one of the things that's changed is that your body has a lot of built-in breaks, a lot of ways to say, hey, things have gone off the rails, let's stop it. Just let's put on the brakes, let's slow this down. And so in the course of cancer evolution, these cells figure out how to remove these breaks. And so what are some of those breaks that are getting removed that allow MYD88 to signal? So one of them that we've learned about is these deletions in chromosome 6q. And this targets a bunch of genes, including the inhibitor of BTK, or IBTK, B-cell development genes such as FOXO3, genes that help control pro-survival signals such as BCL2, which you might have heard about in the venetoclax talks, this BCLAF1, and then also things that target NF-kappa-B signaling, such as TNF-IB3 and HIV-AB2. Now, the other big thing that we've seen as a break are these mutations in CXCR4. Now, we were the first people to actually describe the existence of CXCR4 mutations in cancer. And this was a plenary paper in Blood. And interestingly, what we've discovered is that there's actually some overlap between these two events. They tend to be mutually exclusive. You have one or the other, but they share some signaling. And this is actually a recent paper that was just published by myself and Dr. Guerrera, you can see here. And so we're able to use this new information to say how these things are similar. That gives us some clues about what are the key elements that are changing in WM that allow it to move forward, and maybe eventually give us some new targets that we can go after. Now, these CXCR4 mutations are important, actually, because you can see them in 30 to 40% of WM patients. They're pretty rare outside of WM, and they almost always accompany MYD88 mutations. There are some exceptions, but it's pretty rare. They tend to have very low levels of lymph node involvement, but high levels of IgM, and most critically, they tend to promote resistance to certain therapies, including ibrutinib. So you have much longer time to response and actually quicker relapse for people who have these CXCR4 mutations. So what are they? How do they work? You have this protein here. It's a little complicated, but it makes 7 passes through the cell membrane. And at the very end is this tail. And the interesting thing about this tail is the tail is not actually involved in signaling, at least not in the classical sense. It's involved in turning it off. It's the off switch for the gene. And so what this does, all these mutations, is they are destroying the off switch. So if you don't know how to turn it off, it gets put up there and just signals. And the cell is frantically trying to be like, hey, wait, how do we turn this off? And it can't find that off switch anymore. And so that's what we see going on. And interestingly, about 50% of these mutations are in one location called S338, that's indicated here. And it's basically, again, just truncates, cuts off that end part of the tail. And unlike MYD88, we see a lot of different mutations. This makes it much harder to test for. And so it's something, how we bring sort of CXCR4 mutation detection into clinical practice is something that we can do at the Bing Center, but we as a field are still struggling on how to do this effectively across the country. But hopefully this is something that we'll see improve in the coming years. And CXCR4 has a very distinct transcriptional profile, and a lot of that transcriptional profile is literally removing breaks. It has to do with sort of anti-inflammatory genes that are being upregulated that CXCR4 is effectively bringing back down to healthy donor levels again. So to wrap up, you can think of it as like a little receiver, which is out looking for a particular chemical signal that's actually released by the bone marrow stroma, the lining of the bone marrow itself, that sends out this pro-survival signal and actually helps cells stay in the bone marrow, which is one of the reasons we actually see more bone marrow involvement with these patients as well, and it leads to drug resistance. So when we take this all together, we can start to really build a roadmap for what WM looks like. We have the L265P MYD88 mutation. Within that group, we can have, are you CXCR4 mutated or not? And then we have this other group that we up until quite recently, we were really trying to define, which is, what about those patients who are wild type for MYD88? Well, we figured we needed to study this. And actually, when Steve likes to point out, when we first rolled out our discovery of MYD88, we're talking about 95 to 97% of WM, guaranteed when we present this at conferences, people will be like, oh, that's nice, but what about that 2 to 3%? So we have the answer, at least part of the answer now. So the first thing we discovered is that these people are very hard to diagnose. There's a lot of things that are very similar to WM, particularly IgM, multiple myeloma, that need to be very carefully screened out. But once you do that, you can see just from a clinical perspective that these patients are pretty different. They have lower overall survival rates, much higher rates of transforming into a high-grade lymphoma, such as diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, and those people who do transform do, again, have slightly lower overall survival rates. So this is, again, why we want to know about MYD88 status, is we really they do really have a different clinical profile. We want to treat these people a little bit differently. And the other thing that's important is we now know what these mutations are. And a lot of these mutations are actually mutations that activate NF-kappa-B and recapitulate actually a lot of the WM signaling, but they do it below BTK. And as a matter of fact, when we look at gene expression signatures, which is a sort of three-dimensional box here, you can sort of see that they actually cluster right in with the rest of WM compared to healthy donor cells. But when you look on a chart of the signaling, here is BTK, out here by MYD88, and all these activating mutations in the wild type group are way, way down here, right next to the NF-kappa-B activation. So blocking BTK is not going to do anything. So we need a new paradigm for treating these people, a new method, a new strategy. But now that we've identified these mutations, we actually have a starting point, just like we did when we discovered L265P. So this is now our new goal, is how do we take this new information, incorporate it in, and figure out how we can develop new therapies for this group. Now, this brings us to the real ultimate thing, which is how do we bring personalized medicine to WM? How do we look at individual tumors, not say, hey, you have Waldenstrom's, therefore you should get this, but look at the characteristics of the individual patient and be like, you know what, based on what we see, we really think this is the best treatment for you. That's where we really want to be. And in order to get there, we're doing something we're calling the 300 Project. We've collected 300 untreated patients with WM, and we are genomically and transcriptionally and epigenomically characterizing all these people and watching over time how people change. What happens? What therapies do they respond to? What are the symptoms that they have? And transformation, overall survival. And again, this will allow us to dissect out the role of some of these rare mutations, how they interact with each other, much the same way we did with MYD88, or with CXCR4 signaling and 6Q deletions. And we really hope that in the future this will bring us into a much deeper understanding of WM and be able to really improve patient care. And one thing I want to point out is that some of the most common lymphomas, such as diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, their big New England Journal level publications were cohorts of 300. And we managed to pull this off in WM. And thanks to many of the people in this room, thanks to IWMF, and so really, really thanks to all of you here, this has been possible. So thank you, and with that, I'm going to actually hand the baton over to Steve to talk a little bit about the clinical work, and thank you very much for your attention.
So what I'm going to talk about in the next couple of minutes is how we've made this benchside to bedside transition with the knowledge of these genomics. And I have to credit here my colleagues Ranjana Advani at Stanford and Leah Palumba at Memorial Sloan, because their participation was critical in being able to run this multi-center study of ibrutinib in relapsed refractory Waldenstrom's disease. And this happened, as I mentioned earlier, because of the recognition of BTK as a downstream target of the mutated MYD88 molecule. And as part of this trial, we wanted to see what the impact of the MYD88 as well as CXCR4 mutation status for patients would be in terms of the outcome. So first off, this was a relatively sick population of patients. The average number of prior therapies that patients had going on this trial was 2, and some had up to 9 prior therapies. So you have to think about, you know, how advanced the disease was for some of these patients. And you can see, in fact, that their tumor burden was fairly high, 60% involvement of the bone marrow on average, and about 60% of the patients had enlarged lymph nodes. And despite these characteristics, what was outstanding about this trial was to see how fast things changed. In fact, by the time the patients came back 4 weeks later, taking their daily ibrutinib, many of them were already in a major response. You saw the IgM levels drop quite abruptly. And we see that with other drugs. But what really impressed us, which we don't see with other drugs, is how fast the hemoglobin went up. And in fact, you know, when you look at the best hemoglobin response in this trial, you know, patients went from about 10.5 to 13.8. So that's a highly significant increase. These are the overall response rates that we just updated at the American Society of Hematology. This paper was also published in the New England Journal. And the overall response rate for all the patients that participated on this trial was 90%. 3/4 of them had what we call a major response, so at least a 50% reduction in their disease burden. And VGPR means very good partial response, so it means about 90% or better reduction in disease burden, and that was seen in 27% of patients. But what I want you to look at is the genomics, you know, for these individuals. When in fact you look at the genomics, what you'll see is that the patients that did not have a MYD88 mutation, they seldom actually got, you know, deep responses. In fact, in this trial, none had. But those that had the MYD88 mutation, but no CXCR4 mutation, everyone responded. In fact, major response was seen in 97% of the patients, and almost half of them actually got those very good partial responses. And things were a little different. If you had the mutation in CXCR4 as well, those major response rates, particularly the very good partial response that you see here, weren't as good. The other point that I want to make is when you look at the time to get into those major responses, it was very different as well. It was 2 months. If you didn't have the CXCR4 mutation, it was 6 months if you did. Now, we're doing a little bit of cherry picking here, I have to be honest, because in any trial that we would run, you know, even a 66% response rate would be outstanding. It's just that here you have such outstanding responses, particularly in the wild type population, that makes this relative argument, you know, a little bit challenging. But I do want to show you these differences because I want to show you solutions in just a few moments. These are now the updated data from the progression-free survival, showing us how long these responses last. And I think, first of all, here's the good news. We have not hit yet the median progression-free survival, meaning that, you know, most patients continue to respond. In fact, the projected progression-free survival now exceeds 5 years. So this, again, is remarkable when you think about how heavily pretreated these patients were. But within those populations, you see differences based on the genomics. You know, those patients that did not have the MYD88 mutation drop off very early. Those that do well, especially the ones that have no CXCR4 mutations. You see the bar line very high up here. Those that had a CXCR4 mutation, their median progression-free survival was just shy of 4 years. And again, this is really outstanding when you think about, you know, where these patients are, but it still represents, you know, a challenge that we're prepared to meet. Now, in terms of overall tolerance of therapy, it was really good. The patients that had the most prior therapies were the ones that tended to show the decreases in blood counts more so. And about 10% of patients now with an expanded experience can experience arrhythmias. It's important to know that almost all of these patients continue on ibrutinib despite the atrial arrhythmias because we're able to medically manage those in the vast majority of cases. Now, as a result of this work, we were able to publish the study again in the New England Journal of Medicine. This is considered an absolute home run, you know, in medicine when you're able to get a publication there. And this publication in turn is what supported the FDA approval for ibrutinib. And so in January of 2015, the FDA approved ibrutinib as the first drug ever to treat Waldenstrom's. And this followed then by approvals by the European Medicine Agency, which guides approvals throughout Europe, Israel, Health Canada, and many other. In fact, now over 80 countries at this point, you know, have approved the use of ibrutinib for the treatment of Waldenstrom's. And I have to say, this is where you need to give yourselves a round of applause, because this is absolutely made possible because of the IWMF funding that led to the MYD88 mutation. So a round of applause to all of you. No, I think this is remarkable, and I'll tell you why as Peter's putting us back online, because once you get a drug approved, you know, you set up basically a pathway that other pharmaceutical companies can now pursue. And this is why we're seeing a lot of interest now in the development of new drugs for Waldenstrom. I have to also point out that my colleague Thanos Dimopoulos in Greece also led an effort to look at ibrutinib by itself in Rituxan refractory patients. These are patients that no longer tolerated rituximab, and it wasn't really helping them. And even here, they saw the very high overall response rates and durable results. But they also saw the same thing with CXCR4, that the time to get the IgM down if you had the CXCR4 mutation was slower than if you did not. And they also saw a slightly, you know, slower time to get that hemoglobin up. So again, another study that points to these differences based on CXCR4. And now here comes the study of ibrutinib in patients that have not been previously treated but are symptomatic. So these are treatment naive patients. And this data is now going to be updated at the European Hematology meeting in just a few weeks' time. But everyone on this trial responded. These were all MYD88 mutated patients. And when you see, in fact, you know, the differences in response based on CXCR4, you see basically the same patterns. Very good partial responses. You see this big difference whether you will have no CXCR4 mutation or if you do. And that lag time to response is there as well. Now, why that's important for us to recognize is because, you know, many clinicians will usually treat somebody for a couple of months, and then afterwards, you know, if they're not seeing really any response, they'll say, okay, time to move on. So that's why it's important to know about somebody's CXCR4 mutation status. You can set the expectations appropriately for that particular patient. Now, to me, this is probably one of the most exciting slides that I'm going to be able to show you today, because it involves really one of the hardest things to treat in Waldenstrom's, and that's this entity called Bing-Neel syndrome. This is when the Waldenstrom's, you know, becomes involved in the brain. You know, I used to see, you know, maybe one or two of these a year, and we're talking in over 1,000 patients per year that we see with Waldenstrom at our center. And now we're seeing 3 to 4 of these per month. And this change has happened because as patients are living longer, this has become one of the areas where infrequently, and I want to make sure you heard the word infrequently, you know, their disease can come back. And that's because the brain itself is a sanctuary. There are a lot of drugs that can't get into the brain. And that's why we think, you know, the Waldenstrom's can relapse there. And this was a very tough entity for us to treat. In fact, we used to use high-dose chemotherapy. And even with that, we caused a lot of toxicity and in most cases didn't really benefit the patient that much. But things have changed again, and this is largely because of ibrutinib. And at higher levels of the drug, we actually can see the drug penetrating into the brain. We can pick it up in the cerebrospinal fluid when we measure it concurrently with plasma cell levels. And this was probably one of the worst cases of Bing-Neel syndrome that we treated. And in fact, you see the tumor right there. You know, there's a lot of involvement here. If we do a PET scan, all those yellow areas means that there's active tumor because this is all lighting up. And just look 4 months later how much things have changed. And this has really now become the new paradigm for treating Bing-Neel syndrome. And my colleague, you know, Jorge Castillo will be presenting some of that data later this year and the success of using a higher dose ibrutinib in this patient population. Now, in addition to ibrutinib, you know, the door has now opened for a lot of other new drugs. There are other BTK inhibitors in play, acalabrutinib, there's this drug BGB3111. There's also a different type of BTK inhibitor that binds to Bruton's tyrosine kinase called SNS062. All of these are being evaluated in Waldenstrom patients, and we should be hearing about these drugs very, very shortly at the upcoming meetings. Now, in the next couple of slides, I just want to talk about enhancing these BTK inhibitors, because no matter what drug we develop, you know, we can go back to the, you know, the first development of Rituxan that we were involved with, and then all the other drugs, Velcade and bendamustine, et cetera, you know, the first thing you try to do is to improve their performance. And so, not surprisingly, one of the attempts right now to improve the performance of ibrutinib is to see if you add Rituxan to it, you know, can you make things better? And this is actually a very large trial in treatment-naive and previously treated Waldenstrom's patients called the INNOVATE study. 45 centers participated in 9 countries, and 150 patients were randomized to either get ibrutinib Rituxan or get the standard of care, which is what's used in most centers and private practices, which is rituximab itself. And if the patients, you know, didn't tolerate Rituxan, those were the patients that I mentioned to you earlier that Dr. Demopoulos had treated with ibrutinib alone. We're going to hear about this trial very shortly. It's being presented at the American Society of Clinical Oncology, and it has now been accepted in also a very, very prestigious journal. I can't tell you which journal because I'm barred, but I can tell you it's very prestigious. You can think about which journal that is. To tell you, it's a coup for Waldenstrom to be in that journal again and again and again. So, even after this study, we're still going to have some questions because the activity of ibrutinib is so high, you know, we're going to have to look at what population the addition of rituximab will be able to make things better. And so this is now one of the open-ended questions that we hope to address in months to come. Now, I mentioned CXCR4, and Dr. Hunter talked very nicely about CXCR4 and how it works. There are ways to block CXCR4. There are a number of drugs that have been developed, including this drug, ulocuplumab. Now, it's a little bit above the screen there, but you can probably make it out, ulocuplumab. It took me forever to be able to learn how to pronounce it, but this is a monoclonal antibody that you give it, and it actually binds to CXCR4, and it prevents the activating agent, SDF1, from turning it on. And so we have now this ongoing trial of ulocuplumab plus ibrutinib in those patients that have the CXCR4 mutation. And I'll tell you right off the bat, we're very excited by the initial results that we have. This is a dose escalation study, so we're going to continue to turn up the ulocuplumab dosing as we move forward. I have to thank here the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society for making the funding possible that allowed us to be able to drive this study forward. But really look at this as really your second opportunity when you think about, you know, MYD88 and now CXCR4 both representing targetable mutations in Waldenstrom's disease. Now, not all CXCR4 mutations are sinister. And this is a trial that we're going to be talking about, a study that we're going to be talking about at the European Hematology Society very shortly. You know, we looked at aggregate at all those different types of CXCR4 mutations. Dr. Hunter mentioned there were over 40 of them. Roughly half of them are what we call nonsense mutations. That's where you take the scissor and you cut off that tail. That's what we call nonsense mutations. You lob off the tail, it's gone, and that causes the problem. But there are also these mutations called frameshift mutations. And what basically you're doing there is you're garbling the genetic code, so you're ending up with a scrambled protein. Turns out maybe those scrambled proteins aren't as bad when it comes to a drug like ibrutinib. And this is a study that he'll be presenting showing, in fact, that if you have those frameshift mutations, you do almost as well as the patients that have no CXCR4 mutations. So going forward, it really is going to highlight the need to test for the nonsense mutations. Now, BCL2 is overexpressed. This is a protein that actually blocks how drugs kill cells. And Dr. Hunter very nicely demonstrated this in his paper in Blood. And just a couple of words on BCL2. Now, this was what I showed them in South America, which is you got one team, and anytime you talk about Brazil, Argentina going at it in soccer, you get everyone's attention. But here you have one drug here, like ibrutinib, a player here, who's trying to score a goal. But then you've got the other team trying to block this. And this is what BCL2 does. Now, here in the United States, maybe we can frame this better in terms of football. You've got the New England Patriots here. And then you got Carl Harrington's favorite team over here, you know. And so the goal is how to knock these guys out. As we learned at the last Super Bowl, it's kind of hard. And for you Canadians, how many Canadians here in the audience? Because you can only put things in terms of hockey for them to understand. So here you go, the same analogy but with hockey in mind. So we do have actually drugs to knock out BCL2, and that's this drug venetoclax. Dr. Castillo talked to you about this yesterday. Why we're excited about this is because when we do sensitivity tests, treating Waldenstrom cells with ibrutinib, we see very little, you know, induction of killing. We even put this ABT199, and we see very little by itself, but you put the two drugs together and look at all of a sudden the signature for these cells dying. So what perhaps Dr. Castillo alluded to you yesterday was that we've done now a trial of venetoclax in Waldenstrom's patients, and in fact, we've seen some remarkable results. These will be presented at the European Hematologist Society meeting very, very shortly. But this is really the concept going further, is combining ibrutinib along with venetoclax. And this study is actually going to be opening up, hopefully, at the end of this summer. But it'll give us also an opportunity to see that if we can give the two drugs together and get patients into these complete responses, maybe we can stop both drugs and then just monitor patients. And only after they relapse, maybe have to restart ibrutinib. And if they don't get there, we just continue the ibrutinib along and stop it at some point and assess once again, you know, once the patients progress, you know, about using ibrutinib at that time. So it will allow us now to have the opportunity to see if a defined period of time might be possible with this drug. So at this point, I'm going to turn over to my colleague Wang Yang, who will now run the next, you know, part of this marathon. Wang?
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm very happy to be here today to share with you our research progress recently we made. So like you heard from Hunter and Steve about our research progress, and our genomic and signaling studies not only allow us to better understand WM diseases, also led to a several successful clinical trials, like Steve just mentioned. And from these clinical trial results, some questions came back to us. And one of the questions is, why no complete responses to ibrutinib? So from Steve's talk, you already learned if you have CXCR4 nonsense mutation, you tend to have lower response to ibrutinib. Or you have higher level BCL2 expression levels, you tend to also have less response. Another reason is that when you look at the signaling pathway driven by mutant MYD88 in WM, that we figured out in the last few years. Actually, one reason is may caused by IRAK signaling. Like in this 2013 blood paper, we presented that mutant MYD88 can drive diverse downstream signaling, including IRAK and BTK. And ibrutinib blocks BTK activation but leaves IRAK signaling intact. This is exactly what we detected in WM patients. Compared to untreated WM patient bone marrow tumor cells, we saw high levels of IRAK1, IRAK4, and BTK activation. But with ibrutinib treatment, more than 6 cycles, the BTK activation was dramatically shut down, but IRAK1, IRAK4 activation level keep intact. It's just like when you have running water in your kitchen, you turn off the hot water, but you still have the cold water running. So you have to turn both hot and cold water down. Off in order to stop the running water. So this is exactly the idea we're trying to do. We combine the ibrutinib with a toolbox IRAK1/4 inhibitor, and we saw very pronounced tumor cell killing when we combine this drug, two drugs together. And this is what we reported in 2013 blood paper, that the combination of ibrutinib with IRAK1/4 inhibitor produced pronounced inhibition of NF-kappa-B and produced synergistic tumor cell killing in WM cells. And later, we found that the Iraq 1 plays more important role than Iraq 4 in supporting WMCL survival. This comes from our knockdown study. What we did is we knocked down Iraq 1 or Iraq 4 in WM cells, and we observed more pronounced cell deaths with Iraq 1 knockdown compared to Iraq 4 knockdown. So this led us to collaborate with medicinal chemistry group in Harvard Medical School to develop a novel Iraq 1 inhibitor. Our lead compound GH1X118 showed very selective Iraq 1 inhibition. The kind of scans showing you here only inhibit three kinases. Three enzymes got inhibited by this drug. Compared to existing drugs on the market, this is very selective. Inhibitor is very promising inhibitor. So when we combine this GHX119 Iraq 1 selective inhibitor with ibrutinib, we saw synergistic tumor cell killing in both WM cells and ABCDLBCL cell, which also carries MYD88 mutation. So also I want to thank Leukemia and Lymphoma Society to support our research on this project. So another question came from the ibrutinib clinical trial results is why patients acquired ibrutinib resistant while on ibrutinib. I want to mention that not many patients developed the acquired resistance, only like few patients we saw this progress on ibrutinib. Most of patients respond well to ibrutinib. But with about 100 patients treated, we have 6 patients progressed on ibrutinib. And Lian Zhu in our lab worked together with Dr. Hunter, performed next generation sequencing for MYD88, and the genes listed here, which people know related to ibrutinib resistance, like CXCR4, BTK, PLC gamma 2, CAR11, LIN, etc. So among these 6 patients, they identified 3 patients acquired BTK mutations. And all these BTK mutations affect one amino acid, is cysteine-481. So patient 2 and 3 carries multiple mutations, and the patient 3 also have a CAR11 mutation. Patient 6 had only one BTK C41 mutation, but also carries PLC gamma 2 mutation. So more importantly, all these mutations we all detected in the patients are subclonal. None of them presented a full clonal BTK mutation. We also checked patient 3 at multiple time points. Starting at month 22, we're starting to detect BTK mutation. And we saw the C41 mutation, one of the clone, gradually increased over time, but still stay in subclonal stage. So we then wanted to understand what the mechanism causing this acquired ibrutinib resistance. So George and Xia in our lab created cell models that can produce BTK C41S mutation that causing abortion resistance in two WM cell lines, and also two ABCDLBCL cell lines, which also carries Mendelian mutation. With this cell model, we confirmed the cells can produce this mutant protein actually become resistant to abortinib. And the signaling study showing you here, I'm not going to talk about detail, but showing that the abortinib can shut down wild type and a control called vector control signaling on BTK and its downstream PLC gamma 2 and ERK, but no, cannot shut down the BTK C41S mutant cells. So this make the cells persistently produce cytokines and become resistant to abortinib. So then we screened multiple cytokines using a assay called the multiplex cytokine assay to detect in WM cell lines and ABCDLBCL cell lines what's the cytokine production changes under abortinib treatment or under ERK inhibitor treatment, and what happened to when we combine both inhibitor together. Like you see here, the blue color indicates the lower level of cytokines listed here. And the yellow and brown color indicates higher level cytokines detected in these cell lines. So compared to wild type cell line, the mutant cell lines still keep turned down the cytokine levels while under abortion treatment. And the ERK1/2 inhibitor could block the cytokine release in BTK mutant cells. And even more by combination of abortion with this ERK1/2 inhibitor. Then we think about why abortion treated patients, patients acquired this mutation only presented as subclonal, but not fully clonal. So we thought about this, and we think maybe the mutant cells can somehow protect the wild type cells killed by the abortinib. So we performed a mixed co-culture experiment. We combined the cell model, which we transduced the wild type or mutant BTK with the wild type untransduced cells. Then we see under abortinib treatment, the untransduced cells got also protected, resistant to abortion treatment. Going further, we separate them, these cells, with a membrane which doesn't allow the cell penetrate through, but only allows cytokines pass through the membrane. When we perform this experiment, the wild-type cells, together with non-transduced cells, treated with abortinib, we're still seeing the cell killing by abortinib. But when we do the co-culture with mutant cells and non-transduced cells, we saw the protective effect. Abortinib no longer can kill the wild-type cells. And later, we tested what cytokine from these BTK mutant cells can protect the wild-type untransduced cells. And we found like IL-6 and IL-10 actually placed a major protective effect. It's just like the Roman army. The frontline soldiers carries BTKs, C4 device, shields, which protect the whole army from arrow attack. In this Roman army, we can call soldiers collaboration. In the tumor cells, we call clonal cooperativity. So we published this work in recent in March, and we got a very nice commentary paper published together with on the same issue to talk about our work. So then we thought about a strategy how to overcome the ibrutinib resistance. This slide shows you we tried to combine ERK1/2 inhibitor ulixertinib with ibrutinib. And the signaling study we saw is the combination really of these two drugs really blocks the resistant ERK1/2 signaling, and also the causing more cell killing by both apoptosis analysis or synergistic analysis. The more red color means more synergistic tumor cell killing. So using this cartoon, I would like to show you the strategy we prefer to treat WM patients who acquired BTK mutations. Like while under ibrutinib treatment, some patients develop BTK mutation and acquired ibrutinib resistance. And some doctor may thought about stop the ibrutinib, change to other drugs. We thought this may not be a good idea because ibrutinib still inhibits wild type cells to produce cytokine or suppress the tumor cell survival. The only thing we need to do is, on top of ibrutinib, using ERK1/2 inhibitor together with ibrutinib to stop the mutant clone to proliferate or stop the protection effect on the wild-type cells. So this will turn more effective treatment strategy. So when we look at this signaling pathway we illustrated in the last few years, like I mentioned, like we know how to turn off the running water in kitchen, but sometimes you got water running still in bathroom or somewhere. So what we should do, we should find the main switch somewhere down to the main down the basement. So the main switch, you turn it off, you automatically turn off the running water. So here, the ACK is the main switch. We thought it's not only drives BTK, but also can trigger ERK mechanism signaling, also PI3K AKT signaling. So if we shut down ACK, we can shut down most of the mutant mediated driven survival signaling. It's just like this slide showed you, the Hoover Dam blocks the water going to downstream. So we collaborate with medicinal chemistry group in Harvard Medical School to try to develop a novel ACK inhibitor. This slide shows you the ACK inhibitor lead compound we developed recently. And the kinome selectivity is pretty good for kinase inhibitor to target ACK as well as BTK and some other important kinase to support tumor cell survival. The PK data showing you here that this drug can reach certain levels in the blood and stay long enough to kill the tumor cells. And more importantly, they have very good oral bioavailability, means this drug can be developed as oral drug. And we tested this drug in a mouse model, as I show you here, compared with control, vehicle control, which dissolved the drugs. The ICK inhibitor called SB1G33 really shut down BTK signaling and the ICK signaling, also eliminate the tumor cells from the bone marrow, either by direct cell killing or by the lymphocytosis effect. Then the cells goes to bloodstream, but eventually will be killed by the drug. We also tested this drug in primary WM patients' tumor cells. Like you see here, the novel ICK inhibitor produced higher levels of tumor cell killing, not only the level higher than a known ICK inhibitor, but also higher than abrutinib. More importantly, all this drug doesn't really affect healthy cell, B cell or T cell survival. So that means this drug is really targeted to the tumor cells. More importantly, we found this drug more excitingly can inhibit BTK mutant clone. Like you see here, abrutinib can only suppress wild type BTK signaling, but not mutant BTK signaling. Well, our ICK inhibitor can, no matter you have BTK wild type or mutant, can totally block the signal. And also, you, as you see, the cell survival totally blocked by our new ICK inhibitor. So in summary, our MYD88 and CXL4 mutations are common in WM, and MYD88 activates BTK, ICK in WM cells. And abrutinib produced higher response rate and durable responses in WM, but no complete responses. And this is because either CXL4 or IRAK signaling or BCL2 expression levels contribute these to abrutinib resistance. Also, the BTK mutation-driven LRRK1/2 activation also contribute to the acquired BTK abrutinib resistance. So novel strategies to overcome these abrutinib resistance, including targeting CXCR4, ERK, IRAK, and the BCL2. So I'm gonna turn to Steve. Thank you.
Thank you, Guang, and I just want to also acknowledge all the members of the Bing Center, both the basic science group, the translational group, as well as the clinical group, who have made all this progress possible. And of course, the IWMF, you know, right there front and center, along with many, you know, foundations and private philanthropists who, and our pharmaceutical partners, and the American Society of Hematology, who have helped fund all this progress. If you are interested in any of the trials that we talked about, please feel free to reach out to Chris Patterson, who's been at the booth the last 2 days, and he'll be there again tomorrow. He can certainly connect you to the right individuals if you have any questions about these trials. And I just want to wrap up here by inviting each and every one of you to the 5th International Patient and Physician Summit on Waldenstrom's, which will happen this October in New York City. These summits are pulled together periodically, especially when major advances have occurred. And they're really a unique opportunity to be able to bring clinical investigators together with patients. And it's really a two-way learning opportunity, because you'll be surprised to see how much the clinical investigators can learn from their interactions, particularly with Waldenstrom's patients. I'm always told they're smart. They're absolutely right, because you guys are so well informed, and you keep everyone on their toes. And so Peter is going to help me run the promo for this meeting. You know, I think at the last one we had about 700 to 800 patients come, and it really is a tribute really to our community, how we work together to make these advances possible.
Start spreading the news. I'm leaving today. I want to be a part of it. New York, New York. These vagabond shoes are longing to stray right through the very heart of it, New York, New York. I want to wake up in a city that doesn't sleep and find I'm king of the hill, top of the heap. These little town blues are melting away. I'll make a brand new start of it in old New York. If I can make it there, I'll make it anywhere. It's up to you, New York.
Can't top that off. So I think, Barry, do we have a couple of minutes? We can take a couple of questions. Okay, great.
I'm just curious. It seems to be a mostly older white men who get this disease. And when I was sitting at a table with young WMers, it was all six of us were women who had been diagnosed in our 40s. Is there anything to do with genetics that makes that happen?
Yeah, I'm going to let Dr. Hunter address that, because this is actually a question that is being looked at our institution as to why men seem to be more predisposed to cancers as a whole. Zach, do you want to take that?
I mean, the short version is we don't really know. One thing I can add is, we didn't really talk about it today, but I've done a lot of work looking at predisposition both to WM and related B-cell lymphomas. And we have seen some families which don't follow that trend and actually tend to be largely women. And the mechanism of that, we don't know, but we do know that that exists, and it is something that we're looking at.
Okay, next question, please.
Steve, I'm interested in and excited about the fact that you're going to be publishing soon on the INNOVATE study. And in particular, I'm interested to know, are you going to be saying anything about the patient-reported outcomes? Having been in the study, we filled in questionnaires about our health state, anxiety, all those sorts of mobility, all those sorts of factors. Will you be reporting that sort of information?
Yeah, so there's a lot of data that's been generated as part of the INNOVATE study, and there's going to be, you know, segments of data that will be reported in due time. A lot of these journals have caps on the number of words, you know, per manuscript, especially for the very prestigious journals. So what you can keep in mind is that because of those limitations, you know, there's only so much data. We want to see more genomic data, which will also be coming up in subsequent publications, but there's a lot of data there. But that is something that I know is on everyone's mind, is to look at patient-reported outcomes with therapy, too.
And do you think there's any prospect, even if you don't publish it officially, that sort of information could be made available?
Yeah, no, that's a great point. It can be, but, you know, all these things have to go through multiple layers of, multiple layers of scrutiny and publication, because as you can imagine, particularly when you get down to patient-reported outcomes, there's a lot of variability there, and that really has to be addressed in a very succinct manner. I'm hoping that when we have this meeting in New York, that we're going to have a lot more of that data available to us. That's what's really excited about the summit, is we're going to have investigators from all over the world there, and they're all going to be reporting on all these new drugs, all the new drugs that we talked about today and more. So that's one of the reasons to get excited about the summit and to bring these kind of questions, great questions. Please.
Yeah, I'm interested in finding out my CRCX4 genotyping. And from what I've researched, that you have a homebrew test up there in Boston that does this. And the question is, do I have to come up there to get it done, or can I have it done at a commercial lab? And my second part of my question is, if I'm a Yankees fan, can I still come to Boston?
We're a forgiving bunch.
I don't know, Steve.
I don't know about that one, right?
We'll get back to you on that last part. No, obviously. No, please, please come. So CXCR4 is tricky. So there are commercial tests, and some of them are quite good. The biggest problem, and I think we all touched on this a little bit, is that CXCR4 is not always present in all the tumor cells. So it can be a subpopulation. And a lot of labs are not willing to do the extra work it takes to isolate out the WM cells. And so they'll just take a whole bone marrow pull out. And the problem is that the WM, even in a real packed marrow, are actually only going to be a very small percentage of the cells that get pulled. And so when they sequence, they can say, oh, we have this detection to like 0.1%. Well, actually, they only start detecting the WM at 1% or 2%. So these subclonal things wind up having a very high false negative rate. And this is really the problem. So the number of groups who can do the cell purification and then test are relatively small. And that's really what you need to do to get the accuracy that at least we would want to be able to understand, for instance, the kind of results we see with ibrutinib.
Yeah.
So the short answer to your question is, yeah, pretty much. And we'll make a special Yankees exception.
Yeah, okay. Is that a Sanger sequence that you use up there?
Well, for those nonsense mutations, it's actually PCR-based technology. And I think this revelation that those nonsense mutations are the more important when you think about, you know, ibrutinib, it will shift things so we can actually make more accurate diagnostics. We have to actually credit Leanne Zhu in our laboratory, because She's the one who actually benchmarked the MIDI88 mutation test for PCR and also these CXCR4s. You know, the almost all the laboratories out there that now use these tests is based on the Bing Center, you know, protocols. So we have a lot to be really thankful to her in particular. But being able to do CXCR4 testing correctly is a major challenge. I mean, we get these reports all the time from various clinical laboratories that, you know, reflect a different result than what we're finding when we actually pull out the cells and we do this kind of tedious sequencing. But we use both PCR as well as Sanger to make sure we're picking up both the nonsense by PCR and by Sanger we pick up the frame shift mutations.
Thank you.
Michael?
Is it possible to use CRISPR to edit the mutations out of the genes?
Yeah, Zachary, you can have this one.
I mean, sure, it's not advisable in live patients. So CRISPR technology, for those of you who aren't haven't been following sort of the science section of the newspaper, is a new methodology that was introduced recently to allow researchers to actually edit the genome, which is really exciting, and it means that we can create model systems that are both completely novel or ones that like sort of recreate cells that we see, for instance, in the clinic without in cell lines and in other model systems. The problem is that they don't write in the papers is that they are very specific in their generation, but they also generate some off-target stuff as well. And introducing this into a person as a therapeutic is very, very challenging because we would essentially be generating a lot of mutations in order to target one. So I think we're a ways off from being able to apply it clinically. Where we see it is in immunotherapies where we take out cells, immune cells, and edit them and train them to go after cancer cells. But this works partially because we can screen them and make sure we didn't screw something up. And the cells that get re-injected in all basically have kill switches built into them, so we can eliminate them if something goes wrong.
Great, and I see Barry up there. We'll take Barry as the last question for the evening. Barry?
Thank you, Dr. Treon. This concludes our program this afternoon. I hope everyone enjoys their dinner. And please check around the room. Make sure you take all your belongings. Thank you.